You are listening to WRMU 91.1, the radio voice of Mount Union. This is your host, Christina Zorich, on Stark Actors on the Airwaves. And we have our lovely narrator back, Jamie.
Hi, guys.
We missed you so much.
I missed you guys.
And our co-host, Georgia McCartney.
Hello, everyone.
And Clarice. I never remember how to say it. Is it Knock?
It's Knock.
I always want to say Notch, and I don't know why. Knock.
It's okay.
Yeah. Knock.
Hello.
I think it's because my name is Zortich.
Wabach.
Mine should be Zortich, but it's not.
It's got a CH in there.
No, it actually is Zortich. But since people say have been saying Zortich for so long, we just changed it. Because one of my dad's college professors called him Mr. Zortich, and he was like, "You're the only person who ever said it right." Yeah. Anyway, so we have a continuation of Russel and Quinn. Surprise, right?
Hold on. Explain who we are. And
oh, yes.
Who are we and what do we do?
Who are we? I don't know anymore.
We are.
No.
Stark Actors on the Airwaves. And we were created so that people can write creatively to us. And we can read their stuff on air. And you can come on down and join us. And you could write for us. Or you could read for us. Or you could do both. Whatever is fine with you. And
Christina, if we want to write or read or do any of these things, how do we do them?
That's a good question, Jamie.
You go. Truly.
You go on the Stark Actors on the Airwaves Facebook page. And we also have a Twitter, which is Stark Actors W. That's right, Jamie.
Wait, it's more.
Stark Actors WRMU. And it's pretty sweet. And we're also going to have a YouTube page soon where we have random clips from what we do in the studio. Jamie's looking at me like, what? She hasn't been here in quite some time. So, the first one we're going to start out with is one written by Georgia McCartney. I'm laughing because she put a funny middle name there.
That's not my actual middle name.
I know.
That's really your middle name.
I just realized
that's,
that.
No, that's Russell's middle name.
We can say it on it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure
No, we're not allowed to say that on air.
No, I said I'm pretty sure you are.
Oh, okay. But I was writing the script last night, and I was writing it out, and where I had to put roles and my name and stuff, I put down the title, and then I got to my name, and I was like, Georgia McCartney. Then I went back and I'm like, Georgia Flippin' McCartney. And I'm like, I'm going to submit this, and I wonder if Christina is going to see this. I'm just going to wait, and I'm sitting there. I'm like, Christina, are you going to notice this? And she's like, notice what? And she prints them out, and I'm like, Christina, it's still there. And you're like, oh.
Yeah, well. But what is this about, Georgia?
Oh, I don't know. What is this about? Okay, so, should we read the synopsis from the other script? Because that kind of covers.
Oh, yeah. I'll do it. Should I do it in my epic voice, bro?
Yeah.
Do it in your epic voice, bro.
These are kind of two coinciding stories. One is from a point of view of two characters, and then another is from a point of view of another character. And this will all make sense shortly,
yes.
So bear with us.
So, Jamie, if you have any questions, let us know after the synopsis.
Yeah.
I will.
Because Jamie is like our audience because she's kind of.
I am. I have been away and busy the past couple weeks, so I haven't had a chance to catch up on this. So I am going to be just as
lost.
I'm going to be with you guys, listeners.
Yeah.
I am one of you tonight.
Yeah.
Okay.
I am one of you.
So listen up.
Oh, by the way, real quick, we both wrote an original story, Christina and I, and this is kind of like a spinoff.
Well, not a spinoff, an extra ending.
An extra ending, it's like a different ending.
Alternate ending/universe.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's like we're having fun with it. So
yeah.
It's
we just
kind
wanted
of
to extend their story.
You're like fan fiction in your own fiction.
We are.
It is.
We really
it's
are.
It's awesome. I like that term.
Here is our synopsis for Russel and Quinn. A lot of this you're going to hear already, but it's okay. Russel Ramiro is a journalist who uses his powers of time travel to prevent disasters. Quinn is a con man who has been stealing for longer than he can remember. However, the two of these men become unlikely friends when they meet at a bar one night. Once the two become close, Russel told Quinn he was a time traveler. Quinn took the news well, but then Quinn told Russel that he was a con man. Oh, did I read that twice? I don't know. At first, Russel wasn't happy to hear the news, but he sympathized with Quinn and tried to help him turn over a new leaf. It went well for about 3 months, and then Quinn cracked and stole a painting. Russel went back in time to stop him. Quinn didn't steal the painting, but he fled the scene, and Russel was suspected to be the thief instead. Russel, however, used his time powers to fool a lie detector test to prevent Quinn when the police asked who the real thief was. But after the whole incident, Russel and Quinn didn't hear from each other for a while. Time passed, and Quinn was about to leave town because he didn't think Russel would want to speak to him again after the painting incident. But he was stopped by a strange sight, Russell's ghost.
I was watching Jamie's face. I'm like, here it comes, and you're like,
Quinn is now interacting with Russell's ghost, who doesn't seem to remember how he arrived in his current state. The two then travels to Russell's apartment to look for clues. However, what they found wasn't promising. Because of this, Russel gave up and believed that he was dead. But Quinn gave him hope that he wouldn't let Russel give up until the very end. They traveled back to Quinn's apartment so Quinn could eat dinner and get a good night's rest before searching for more clues to uncover the mystery of Russel.
Jamie's face.
Jamie, what do you want to say? And not kill us.
That's some Scooby-Doo level stuff there, guys.
What?
We have a ghost?
I was just recalling the window scene from the last, episode.
Quinn got caught in the window when they tried to go through his apartment because he thought he was going to see someone. Because they had to go through Russell's apartment. Russell's like, okay, I'm going to face through this door now.
Oh my god!
And then Quinn's like, I'm too fluffy.
Oh my wait, where did that come from? The window? The window scene?
The window was last scene.
Yeah. But what made you mention that?
Because she's mentioned.
I did.
Claire
did.
Oh,
okay. I brought it up. That's what I was signaling you about because I was laughing and I'm like, I'm just remembering the scene where he got stuck in the window. Oh my gosh. Did you see? Well, obviously you didn't see it, Christina, but
when she went,
Jamie's face. It's like, with strange sight, Russell's ghost. She's like, what?
Yeah.
That was epic.
Wait, what moment?
Like,
yes. That was a good freak out. I enjoyed it.
I gotta send you the last two scripts.
But, okay.
Yeah.
Can we read the next one?
Okay. Well, yeah. What we've got here is a script ago. I'll give a brief synopsis if that's okay. A script ago, because this is all happening, you know, Quinn was gonna leave on a bus.
Yeah.
But what happened was he was stopped by the sight, you know, of Russell's ghost. And they're both kind of freaking out, and they're like, what are we gonna do? And then Russell's like, no, this can't be happening. And he's like, I didn't even get to say goodbye to Roseanna. And so they call up Roseanna. And Quinn's kind of beating around the bush, because, I mean, obviously, who won it?
Yeah. How do you even approach that?
Yeah, it was funny because Roseanna's like, oh, hi, Quinn, how are you? Is everything okay? And Christina, when she read that, she typed back to me. She's like, aw, heck no, your boyfriend's a ghost. I'm freaking out. You should be freaking out, too.
That's it. That's the script. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody. We're done. But what happens is they just kind of go over, like, Quinn's like, oh, he's not answering his cell phone, because they're trying to find out what happened to Russel without, you know, saying the obvious.
Yeah.
So Roseanna's like, I haven't heard from him either. So this first script is just kind of going over Roseanna's feelings of not hearing from Russel for, like, 3 weeks, because last time she heard of Russel, he had just gotten out of prison because of the whole painting with Quinn thing.
So, all right, this is I Miss You, Russel by Georgia Flippin McCarthy.
The following is a work of fiction. Please don't sue us. Do we need our little synopsis here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Roseanna Taylor is a professional model. She is dating Russel, but she hasn't heard from him in a long time.
Rose, is everything okay?
Roseanna looked up.
I think so. Sorry. It's all right, but please look at the camera, okay? We can't have a bunch of pictures where you're just staring at the ground. You have such beautiful eyes, and we need to show them off.
Okay.
More cameras flashed, and Roseanna did her best to show the biggest smile she could.
Look, Roseanna, I can't tell. I can tell that you're not into this. Do you need a break?
I'm sorry, but I really do think I need a break.
It's all right. You've earned it. We've been through a lot of these past couple days with all these shoots. Now go on, take a break, and I'll see you back here soon.
Thank you so much. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it already.
Roseanna then walked off to her dressing room. She sat down at her vanity and slipped on her glasses. She looked up at one of the pictures stuck between the mirror and the frame. It was of her and her boyfriend, Russel. He was bearing the same goofy smile that he always did as he rested an arm on her. Roseanna looked at herself in the photo. She was smiling a genuine smile. It had been so long since she last smiled like that. She frowned and picked up her cell phone, dialing Russell's number. Maybe this time it would work.
We are sorry. This number is out of service. Please try dialing the number again.
Again?
Roseanna's heart sank. What was up with Russell's phone? She'd been trying for a while to get a hold of him. Was it off? Did he drop it in the drink or something? Was he just not answering her? No, that couldn't be the case. Russell was never one for the silent treatment. But she was getting worried at this point. According to Quinn, Russell wasn't answering his calls to him, too. The young woman took the photo down and stared at it once more. She then pulled up her laptop and shot Russell an email. Hopefully he would answer that.
Hey, Rose, are you almost done? We should get back to shooting, but I'll give you a few more minutes.
All right. I understand. I'll be out soon.
Roseanna then picked up the picture. She brought it closer to her face and pressed her lips up against Russell's face. She was missing Russell now more than ever. She wished in her heart that whatever Russell was doing, he would be okay until she got back. She walked over and flopped down on her bed. Roseanna looked at the photo of Russell once more and held it to her heart.
I love you, Russell.
A small tear rolled down her cheek. She then sniffed and got up. Roseanna wiped the tear from her eye and shoved the picture into her pocket as she opened the door.
Yeah, I'm ready now. Thanks for the break.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Wow. It's so cutesy.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, even though it's not that long, I think it contained a lot of feels.
That was adorable, bro.
So what'd you guys think?
That was adorable.
I think it's cute that the photographer calls her Rose.
Oh, thanks.
Uh-huh. That is happy.
I picture, like, her and the photographer met, like, in college, and, like, they both, like, got into this job together, so it's kind of cute.
I dig it.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, so any more thoughts before we get on to this?
Say we jump in.
Jump
Let us
in.
Begin.
Jump right. in. Jump in. Jump in. Jump in.
Any
jump in.
Preface we need to this one?
You read the synopsis. So
yeah, we got the synopsis.
Think
so.
We should be good.
So they're at Quinn's house and he's eating.
Okay. And Russell's not. Right.
Aww. Oh, wow, I forgot that literally was the beginning of this.
Yeah. All right. The next one is "We Have Today" by Georgia McCartney and Christina Zortich.
Oh yeah, bro.
Quinn stood over his stove, stirring his rice that was just about to be finished. Boxes were piled on top of each other in his apartment, making it look very bare. Even if his things weren't packed, his apartment would still be bare. He only had the necessities and was quite used to moving all the time. He was glad that he was back home, even though his things were packed. He wished that it could look more like a home for Russell, but this would have to do. Quinn was glad that he finally got to eat, too. He didn't get a chance to have a decent meal all day due to packing and worrying about Russell. He had been running on 3 cups of coffee, a pack of cigarettes, and a few protein bars.
So, do you sleep, Russell? I don't want you bored out of your mind tonight.
I don't think so, honestly. I don't feel things. I don't feel the things that I should be feeling, you know? I don't feel hungry, thirsty, or tired. So, I guess the answer is no. I mean, I could try, but you know what? Don't worry about it. I can find something to occupy myself while you rest.
Quinn nodded as he turned off the stove and reached for a plate.
I don't really have a television either, and I really don't read, so good luck finding something to do.
Quinn readied his plate, putting sauce on it and the cooked carrots and green peppers, and sat down next to Russell, taking a bite from his plate.
Do you have a piece of string, maybe? That could work. But it's okay. In all honesty, I'm sure I'll be able to find something. I mean, I'm pretty easily entertained.
Russell smiled and eyed Quinn's food.
That looks good. Is it good?
Yeah. I make a pretty awesome steak, too. And lasagna. I would probably make those for you if you could eat. Or if I had them in my house. I kept the simple food since I packed up.
Ah, whoa. I can so picture that. You strike me as a good cook for some reason. Roseanna usually does most of the cooking, but I like to help, and I can make a few things. But
But yeah, I appreciate the offer all the same, Quinn. Sometimes it really is the thought that counts.
Quinn nodded and looked around at the boxes.
Now that I've found you, I'm not sure if I should leave or stay. I guess that all depends on if you're actually still alive or not.
Quinn didn't want to think about it. Russel paused and felt a little uneasy at what Quinn had just said. So was he Quinn's only tether to this town? Why had Quinn come to this town in the first place? Was it to steal? Probably. But it could be something else. Russel wasn't sure. He just sat there and thought. He was the reason Quinn was sticking around. Quinn idly moved his fork around the plate. Quinn was sitting on the bar stool at his kitchen countertop. It was just like when they met at the bar, except they were sitting on opposite sides and Quinn wasn't properly dressed. Instead, he was in his white and orange striped shorts and white tank top.
I hope I am alive. I want you to stay, Quinn, for at least a little while longer. You have to be my best man, remember?
I hope so too, Russ. So, I'm assuming that you didn't pop the question yet, or is that an unsafe assumption?
Russel jolted at Quinn's question. The reality of the situation was that Russel was waiting to buy that engagement ring until he proposed to Roseanna. She was so wonderful. She deserved the very best ring, and Russel just couldn't afford something nice enough, so he had waited. Did he wait too long? He looked at Quinn for a moment. He knew Quinn was walking free because he didn't turn him in to get the reward money. Russel began jumping to conclusions. What if he had turned Quinn in? He might very well be married to Roseanna now instead of sitting here as a ghost watching the very man that got him into this mess enjoy a life he couldn't. But if Russel had turned Quinn in, he wouldn't be able to live with himself. Russel wanted a future where all three of them could be happy. Sure, he loved Roseanna, but he wasn't going to dupe his best friend just to get what he wanted, no matter how appealing the odds. But he couldn't help but feel a bit of sadness at his current situation, knowing that he might not get the chance to propose to Roseanna after all. But there was still hope. Quinn was sharing his determination with Russel. And for that, Russel decided he didn't regret what he did. Not one bit. He smiled.
No, I didn't pop the question, but if this all sorts out, I intend to ask as soon as I get the chance. I don't know how or what I'll say when I do, but I'll think of something.
Quinn continued to fiddle with his food idly, not able to make eye contact with Russel.
Hey, you should eat that.
Was that because you were in jail serving time, or is it because you don't have that fancy ring yet? I could have given you that money easily.
No, I was only in jail overnight. They didn't find any evidence to convict me, so I was set free pretty quickly. Look, I know you could have gotten me that money easily, Quinn, but I appreciate the offer, but I just can't, okay? I'm the one proposing to her, so it doesn't feel right.
All right, I guess that's understandable.
Quinn ate a fork full of rice, as Russel suggested. Yeah. He was starving, but he felt that if he rushed, the moment would be ruined. He wanted this memory to be clear to him in the years to come. This might be the last night he ever spoke to Russel. Every moment mattered.
I'm sorry about the whole painting thing. For me being so stubborn and going back on my word, and for you getting caught.
Russel leaned forward on the countertop and rested his chin on his two folded arms.
I accept your apology, Quinn. We all flub up sometime. I mean, we're only human. And I did ask a whole lot of you. But as far as being arrested goes, I'm happy to know that neither of us wanted that to happen. Thanks.
Quinn furrowed his brow. He couldn't help but feel a little offended at Russell's comment.
Wait, what do you mean you asked a whole lot of me? Are you saying that it was too much to ask, or is it okay that I flubbed up? Because it's totally not okay, Russ. Whether you think it's too much or not, you're dead now because of me. Or possibly dead. I don't even know anymore.
Quinn sat his fork down with a clatter, suddenly feeling not so hungry.
I was basically asking you to turn your whole life around. I mean, that's a really big change. I
I mean, I don't think I could change that easily. It's so that's why I stuck by you. I knew it would be hard for you, so I wanted to help you along the way, you know? And it's not your fault. I'm, well, whatever I am right now. We have our proof that I didn't die during that lie detector thing. Unless you killed me or something after that. You didn't kill me, did you, Quinn? Like just off me and now I can't remember it?
Russel shook his head and frowned.
But, no, you wouldn't do something like that. What am I saying? What am I saying? Gosh, just stop blaming yourself. This situation isn't a blame game, you know?
Quinn stood up from his seat.
Kill you? Why would I kill you? Did you think for a second that I'm the kind of person that goes, oh, hey, let me kill my only friend because I accidentally got him in jail and I'm so ashamed of myself that I can never look at him the same? No, I'm not like that at all, Russel. I'm blaming myself because your powers are gone because of me. Maybe I put you in the situation where your life is at risk. Who knows? I certainly don't.
Look, I'm sorry, Quinn, but I don't know why I said that, or even why I thought that.
Russel rubbed his forehead, trying to remember what happened to him more than ever now so he could put Quinn's mind at ease.
And I don't think my powers are gone because of you, Quinn. I still can't remember what happened, but I know that a power transfer is done to save everyone and everything in a current and past time that a current and past time traveler has done. So you're not solely responsible for any of that. Seeing that you were okay just helped me remember the whole ordeal.
Russell's mind then raced. Some of his memory was coming back. He started to regain the thoughts he had before the power transfer. He remembered thinking of many people, many situations, and then one thought hit him. It was a thought about Quinn. So he did think of him then. Just then. Russel remembered the thoughts ending and being cut off by darkness. He frowned. Quinn sighed heavily and rested his hand on the kitchen counter.
What if we don't find out more information sooner? What if by morning you'll be gone? I'll never know when you'll just disappear. I could be having a conversation with you and you'll just go away. For good. And it scares me.
I really hope that doesn't happen. You're kind of scaring me here too. Look, you know what, Quinn? If something like that does happen, I'll do everything in my power to say goodbye to you first. Heck, I'd kick the Grim Reaper where it counts if it comes down to it. So I know it's not much, but I hope that at least helps.
I'll cook him for you, because I'm not letting the Grim Reaper get you. No, that's for bad people like me. I wouldn't let that happen.
And that tears it. I won't be going anywhere until you stop calling yourself a bad person and realize what an awesome guy you really are. Put hugging you on the top of my list of things to do when I get my body back.
Yeah? Well, I appreciate your faith in me.
Quinn stretched his arms up and scratched his stomach. He lowered his arm, trying to hold his hand on Russell's shoulder, knowing it wouldn't work. It was the thought that counted, though. Russel smiled as Quinn did so. It was nice. He appreciated the sentiment. Russel hovered his own hand over Quinn's to return the gesture.
I'll be sure to give you plenty of hugs, too. But as for right now, I should head to bed so we can start off early tomorrow. I don't want to waste any time.
Of course, Quinn. You need your rest. Getting an early start tomorrow is a great idea.
Quinn then began walking down the hallway to his room.
Good night, Russel. I love you, man.
Russel was a bit surprised to hear that. He knew Quinn loved him and that he loved Quinn, but he always thought it would be one of those things where neither of them would really say it that much.
Thanks. You're great, too. I love you, too. You're like a brother to me, Quinn. Like the brother I never had, but wished I did. Good night.
Quinn stopped walking a moment.
You know, I'm glad I went to the bar that night. And I'm glad you were having a bad day at work. Well, only because that's what brought you to the bar. Good night.
Once morning rolled around, Quinn opened his eyes and turned over in his bed, expecting Russel to be sitting there, bored like a little kid as he watched him sleep.
Morning, Russ.
There was no answer. Quinn sat up and looked around his room.
Russel?
Quinn flew the covers off his body and walked to the kitchen, seeing papers scattered all over the table. Quinn searched through the papers. This looked like Russell's handwriting, but where was he? Quinn didn't bother to get dressed and ran out the door.
Russell! Russell, where are you? Did you die? No! No!
After a few moments of searching outside, he saw Russell sitting on a grassy hill watching the sun come up. The light was going through his transparent body, and it was probably one of the most fascinating things he'd ever seen.
Russell!
He waved a hand and called out to him. What was he doing so early in the morning? When Quinn said to get an early start, he wasn't sure he meant this early. Russell heard Quinn's voice. He smiled and turned around slightly to face Quinn. He waved back.
Ah, Quinn. Good morning, buddy. Sleep well last night? Here, wanna come watch the sunrise with me real quick?
Quinn stepped forward and sat down on the dewy grass next to Russell.
I slept well, aside from the fact that you freaked me out this morning. I thought you were gone.
Oh man. I'm so sorry, Quinn. My bad. I just got bored, and I mean, you didn't have any string for me to play with, and watching people in their sleep is just downright creepy, so I figured I'd come out here and watch the sunrise. I'm glad you could join me, but I'm sorry. I didn't mean to freak you out. But hey, I meant it when I said I'm not going out anywhere without saying goodbye or letting you know about it first. I mean what I say, and I say what I mean, Quinn.
You're like a cat, Russ. The kind of cat who can't stay still and chases after random lights. Not the mean ones.
A cat, huh? Well, I'm certainly spazzy enough sometimes.
Quinn put his arm up to wrap it around Russell's shoulder and to nudge his head and ruffle up the man's hair as if they were young boys. But instead, he felt nothing. His arm phased through the other man. Russell jolted and looked over as he felt Quinn trying to touch him. He felt sad, wishing he could return the gesture. Quinn sighed and turned the other way, feeling rather stupid.
I really need to remember I can't do that anymore.
Russell then leaned down and grabbed a few blades of grass. He playfully tossed them onto Quinn's arm.
Yeah, I can still do that, though.
Quinn smiled a little and rubbed the grass off his arm.
That's not fair, Russell. Hey, we'll miss the sunrise if we keep bantering around like this.
Quinn wanted to get off the subject and just enjoy their time together. And as soon as the sun was up, they would get ready for their next adventure.
Okay, Quinn, you're right.
Russell then turned his head to the sky and watched the sunrise. Russell wasn't a morning person at all, at least not without the help of a gallon of coffee, but he didn't enjoy the sight of the sunrise. Plus, without his body, he wasn't feeling tired at all, even though he'd stayed up all night.
It is a lovely sight.
Indeed it is.
The two of them continued to sit in silence and look at the sky until the sun was up. Quinn then stood up and dusted the grass from his pants.
That was nice.
It was.
Well, we should get ready to go. Let me get some breakfast first.
Ah, breakfast! That reminds me. I have a surprise for you. Here, follow me.
Quinn wondered what the surprise would be. Did it have to do with the random papers on the table? Nah, that couldn't be it. The two men then walked back to Quinn's apartment. Once they were there, Russell walked over to the oven. It was on low heat, just enough to keep food warm without burning it. He opened it up and pulled out a plate with a few pancakes stacked on it.
Guess who made pancakes? Ta-da! It was me. I made them earlier while you were still asleep.
Russell set the plate on the countertop along with a fork and napkin. Quinn's eyes widened when he saw the pancakes. Russell smiled and Quinn returned the gesture.
Dig in, buddy.
What? You made breakfast already? Is this because I didn't get any yesterday? Oh, man. Thank you.
It's simply because I can and I wanted to. You're welcome, Quinn.
Quinn sat down at the counter and began to cut his pancakes.
Oh, can't have pancakes without syrup. Is there any left? I don't remember what I packed up.
Ah, I remember seeing some in the fridge as I was getting the stuff out to make the pancakes. So, here.
Russell then retrieved the bottle from the fridge and set it down on the counter.
Hey, you're in luck. It looks like there's just enough left. It feels funny offering you your own food, but whatever.
Quinn lifted the bottle and poured it over his pancakes.
Thanks. Yeah, it is a little weird, but it's okay.
Quinn swallowed his first bite and then chuckled.
Is this what having a lady to cook for you is like? I mean, not that you're a lady, but the fact that you cooked stuff that was in my fridge.
Never mind.
Russel smiled. He knew what Quinn was trying to say, but he felt a little bad for him that Quinn hadn't found that special someone yet. Ah, well. Maybe Russel could help him with that once he was better. If that's what Quinn wanted, that was.
Well, pretty much, actually. Roseanna and I make pancakes for each other all the time now. It all started at one of our sleepovers. I woke her up from the couch, and she showed me how to make these awesome pancakes with fruit. Like blueberries or strawberries. Unfortunately, you were out of those, so I just kind of used what you had. But yeah, at this point, we usually just ask, hey, is it okay if I grab something from your fridge, and we just go for it, you know?
Quinn nodded as he listened and ate. Roseanna and Russel were just so cute together. He wanted someone he could be cute with. Well, okay, maybe not that cute, but he wanted that special something that when people saw them together, they'd say, wow, those two really love each other.
Stop it, you're gonna give me a toothache.
My work here is done then.
Quinn smiled, putting the last of the syrup on his plate.
Okay, guess I'll take this as practice for when I do find a lady. Might be difficult, though, but I'll try my best.
Good, yeah. Just do your best and have fun. I mean, that's what's great about Roseanna and I. We can be ourselves, but we also enjoy going out of our way for each other every so often. But nothing about that. I don't want you to have to go see a dentist. I wanted to tell you that I made a realization last night concerning this whole situation.
Oh? What is it?
Russel gathered up a few of the scattered papers as he spoke.
I was writing down everything that I did remember, and I emphasized points in which my memory is a bit fuzzy. So based on what has happened so far, it looks like I remember things when I see a trigger. Like I remembered my time travel journal when you mentioned journals and stuff and writing things down. So I think our best course of action for today would to drive around town and look for triggers.
Russel shuffled the papers into a neat stack and smiled.
What do you think?
That makes sense. Yeah, I've noticed that too. Although I still don't know where that 215 number came from.
I'm still not sure either, but it seemed like it was an important number, and it still feels like that. It's like when you ask me where I lived, that was the number that came to mind. But we'll put that on the back burner for now, since all it's doing is confusing the both of us right now.
Quinn nodded and chewed slowly, his mind going adrift for a moment.
Sounds like a great idea. Although I'm worried about time. What if we don't have enough?
I really do hope we have enough time. Jeez, I'm kind of starting to miss my powers now. If I still had them, I could make a crack right now, but I don't.
Russel then shook his head.
But we have today, Quinn. We'll do our best to see what we can uncover.
All right. We'll leave as soon as I finish these delicious pancakes and get dressed.
We only have today. That sounded like a good philosophy. One to live by, actually. Time is irrelevant. Everyone only has today. Because memories are just images and feelings from the past. The future is only what we want and dream of. And Quinn's future consisted of Russel being his friend, being the awkward third wheel whenever Roseanna was around, being his best man. And he didn't want anything to change that.
The end. We killed you with feels. You're like a little dinosaur over there. You're like,
dude, when we said, what if you killed me? They're both like,
I didn't get to see those faces because I was like looking at the script and like, I want to look up their faces so bad. Yeah, what were your faces like when he was like, what if you killed me?
I just.
No!
It's not okay!
It isn't. Well, Russel only said that because, like, you know how Quinn, it's like, man, I'm sorry. He's like,
yeah, why are you so sorry?
Why are you so sorry? Is this. Did you kill me? Why so serious? Why are you so sorry? It's like, you didn't kill me, did you? That was his logic.
No, he wouldn't do that.
He wouldn't. That's why Russell's like, no, you wouldn't do that. Like, 3 seconds
I'm
later.
I'm starving. And aww. That pancake thing.
Yeah, those pancakes sounded good.
I know.
I had pancakes this morning, and it was making me think of them, and I was like, I really want more.
So what'd you guys think of the script?
Pancakes.
Okay, who keeps their maple syrup in the fridge?
I do.
Everybody but you, Jay.
Whoa.
Okay, forget I said anything.
Guys, you should tweet us or Facebook us on if you keep your syrup in the fridge.
Yeah, because I...
Mm. You don't? I just always thought that was, because then it gets all like cold and thick and it's hard to.
For some reason, I thought I knew someone here was going to say, mention that. So I was just like, should it be in the cupboard or should it be in the fridge? I don't know. I just keep
it. I mean, it's fine. I don't care if you keep it in the fridge. I just thought it was.
I keep it.
Okay. My worldview is skewed.
It is.
Go away, Jamie. I also want to point out the fact that I appreciate that it is accepted that just watching someone sleep is really creepy. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. It would have been a little weird if it would be, because Christina's like, what is Russel going to do? I'm like, I'm not sure. We'll think of something. And it's like,
if he runs away and Quinn thinks he's gone?
Yeah, we're like, oh, that's the evilest thing I can think of. We're like, let's make it happen. So it's like, okay, let's scare the crap out of Quinn. It's like, okay, now what's Russel doing? He's watching the sunrise, and I'm like, because that would be sweet. Oh, now we can talk about the picture I drew you, because, I drew Christine this picture.
I don't think it's on my phone, but I can look.
Yeah, but in the picture, Russel is sitting there on the grassy hill, and the light's shining through him, and Quinn's just kind of walking up, and he's just looking, and it's really nice. Yeah,
it's inspirational.
Nice. It is inspirational. Just like have that underneath, like an inspirational poster of that picture, and then it's like, don't give up.
Oh, don't give up.
Don't give up, even though your best friend is like a ghost right now. You don't know what happened to him, and you're kind of running out of leads. But don't give up.
It will work out in the end. I swear.
You're like looking at us. It's we'll work out in the end. But it will.
It will.
It will.
It has to.
It has to. So, give me more of your thoughts. I want to hear.
Their friendship is so cute.
It is.
I was thinking of, I don't know if you guys have saw Scrubs, and I keep on bringing this
up. Oh, yeah!
Was it from Scrubs where it was like, there was this guy who's talking to his wife, and it's like, why don't you love me like that? It's like, because I don't love you like he does. Yeah.
I know.
It's like that best friend thing.
I was going to say, that is their relationship. Like, I think it's, like, it wasn't initially, but it's kind of like getting there. And if they, like, do, like, finally, like, everything works out, I think it's going to be, like, that relationship.
Yeah. I really like how close they've become. It's like, and we had a reference to the very first script here, where it's like, it's just like meeting at the bar.
Yeah.
And then it's like, only so much is different. If you look at my drawing style, actually, this is kind of bad because it's like explaining visuals on air, but anyway, if you look at, like, when I drew, like, Quinn in the first picture when they're at the bar, and then look at the sunset picture, which is the most recent picture they look so much different because I've improved on drawing Quinn so much.
Aww.
And it's just like so much development has happened between these two characters between now and then.
I like it.
Thank you.
I was literally like thinking that when you were talking about, oh, I love you, and then he was like, I don't think it's like the awkward I love you, but like we're at the relationship, and I'm like, Scrubs!
Yes!
And I haven't heard the song in so long, but it was going through my mind. I'm like, yes!
Yeah, if you, I'm a nerd for my own script, so I'm like, did Quinn ever say he loved Russel before? And I looked back, and he did say he loved Russel at the donut shop when all three of them went to the donut shop.
I love you guys, yeah.
Yeah, he said, I love you guys. And then he said, I love you right before he stole that flipping painting. Russell's like, don't do this, Quinn. He's like, sorry, Russel, I love you, man, but I can't.
Seen it three times.
I like how naturally it happens, too. Because it makes sense that he'd do the, like, I love you guys, because it's kind of more, like, distance, and there's more of them there. And then the really high stakes moment, he'd say, I love you, and then, like, a moment
like
this.
I love you, but I gotta do this.
Because I feel like those set up this one.
Yeah,
and it wasn't forced. You weren't just like throwing it in there.
Now they gotta say they love each other. No, it really came because I didn't know Christina was gonna say that.
Yeah, you're like, oh, don't he say I love you? And I'm like, it just kind of happened.
Yeah, this was the first time Russel said he loved Quinn though.
Yeah, but like it's like it feels like it's okay because it's been said before,
and now they actually like really mean it.
Yeah, and now they can just like casually, well, not casually, but like say it like comfortably and like have it not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I see what you
like
mean.
That.
Thank you.
I like that a lot.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm glad you appreciate our writing, because we really put a lot into this, and then when, like, other people admire it,
we wrote this, all over the weekend, didn't
we? We kind of
Saturday
did.
And Sunday, and we're just like, write.
Write.
Got nothing to do.
You want to write? It's like, I want to write.
Because usually we're waiting until Wednesday night. We're like, oh, got to think of a script.
Yeah.
How long does it usually take you guys?
A while. With these ones, they're like, 10 pages. So
yeah, I know. Like, I'm sure it can take you a while.
Five days.
No, I mean...
hours long.
Yeah, that's what I was meaning towards.
We kind of do.
But if we don't goof around, maybe like 3 hours for a script.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's pretty quick. Yeah.
Oh, one time we sat down for like 5 hours. Yeah. But we were also goofing around and being weird.
Yeah, I don't really keep track. It's just like, it's like, okay,
yeah,
script's
done.
Yeah,
it's just
done. Fun. Yeah, it is. Yeah,
you guys always have one, though. Like, I'm impressed. Like, you because, like, I personally, like, if I were to have to write a music or write something, it can't be forced. Yeah. And like, you guys are, like, have to each week.
That's
and,
what's great about them, because we're so excited to write about them. It's not even a chore anymore, because beforehand, we were like, ugh, no one else was writing for us. Mm. It gets kind of tedious. We're like, we're running out of ideas. What are we going to do? And then we started with Russel and Quinn. We're like, let's keep going.
I was going to say, like, a series is, like, freaking perfect for, like, this kind of show.
Yeah. So. Yeah. I kind of realized that it's better for the show and for us as writers, because we get excited about it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. We're always, like, spazzing out all the way here. It's like, you know when Quinn says this? And we're like, you know when Russel says this?
Yeah. We fangirl a lot. Or, like, you would just be over on a random weekday or the weekend and be like, remember when this happened in our script? And I'm like, yeah.
And, like, other people would be there and we're, like, being complete nerds. I'm like, I should include other people. Nah! Yeah,
nah!
Oh, Jamie, Clarice, you're too. You're here, too.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
Hey, guys. What's up?
Hi. It's just you guys. Yeah, we're over here.
It's okay. Oh. We'll start our own fandom, Clarice.
You guys should. Well, yeah, I'm writing with both of you, actually. Yeah. I sent you that document of my character, so.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, I'll try. Like,
huh? I want to write with your money.
Yeah.
Oh, I got some ideas, but.
Oh, tell me.
I don't know, like.
Oh, okay.
You were going to continue with the one we did last. The episode with my character that I've been doing.
Oh, you've got a character now?
Well, no.
The one
no,
she's
Abigail.
Abigail and everything.
Oh, yeah.
And so I don't know if you're going to continue on it, but if you need help, some ideas for a cutesy stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I totally do that.
Yeah, just tip me up if you have ideas. Just, guys, be creative with us. Don't be afraid to be creative with us. Just because
that, and that means Christina. The audience, too. Like,
exactly, you guys,
I
want to
be Liam again.
Liam,
you have to be active listeners.
Yes. Listen, like, if you're like, hey, I want to join in the fun, just hit us up on, like, Facebook or Twitter. But, yeah, don't be scared off about, like, you're like, oh, man, Christina and Georgia just write good stuff and I'm not good. It's like, no, this... Like, you're good, too. And
don't be intimidated.
Yeah, and it's not like we sat down and we're like, we're going to write this epic story. We're just like, hey, I love this character. Hey, I love this character. They should meet. Yeah. And that's literally what happened.
And their enthusiasm gets everyone else excited about it. So if you have something that you're excited about, like, I don't care if it's, like, crazy off the wall. If you're excited about it, this group of people will be excited about
it. It's contagious.
Yes. It is.
It really is.
Aw. Well, hey, crazy off the wall. We've got to, like, former time traveling ghost here. I don't think you're gonna get much crazier than
don't tempt people.
No, I will tempt them. You're take, like, that as a challenge.
Yes,
do it.
Yes. Oh, awesome.
All right,
I'm really hungry, but we have 10 minutes left.
Thoughts, hopes for the next script?
More pancakes.
Yeah. I made the rules up for Russel that.
Wait, you talk.
Yeah, oh, okay. Tell us about Russel being able to make pancakes, but
not being able to touch Quinn.
Yeah.
Yeah. The rules for him is he can touch inanimate objects just fine, but he can't touch living things.
Okay.
And the rules for seeing people, like, I'll give you a little insight here. It's he can see everyone, but the only people that can see him are people he's known.
Oh.
But
okay. So people he knew. Okay.
People he knew.
Can I put you on the spot with a question?
Go ahead.
With this, him touching inanimate objects and everything, does he have just his regular strength, or could he, like, pick up a couch with a hand?
His just regular strength.
Okay. That's just a question. I didn't mean to, like, put you on the spot since you might not have thought of that.
That's
but.
Not a... I think through this a lot, so.
Okay.
You'd be hard-pressed to find something. Christina, you're like, she does. You're just like, looking at me, she does. But no, that's why he kind of had trouble opening the window, because he doesn't have super strength.
Yeah,
he still
is
the same as he was.
So he's kind of a little weak.
Little bit.
Just a little bit. It's okay. It's okay if guys are just a little bit.
Super powerful. But what were you going to say, Christina?
Oh, okay. When I was writing the pancake scene, Georgia was like, is it just me or is Quinn adorable even when he eats? And I'm like, no, it's not just you. He is.
Because you're like, because this woman loves Quinn. Just like with every fiber of her.
Really? I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know when I got that vibe before.
I know.
That's surprising to me. That's really surprising.
I know, I love with every fiber of me.
Sarcasm on the side. She's just like sharing her love with Quinn. She's like, man, look at him.
Puddle of sarcasm right now.
She's just like, look at him in his PJs and look at him eating his pancakes. And I'm like, yeah. And Russell's there too. And she's like, he is.
He is.
Who made him the pancakes?
No, they just manifested.
They just manifested.
He just only exists to serve the cuteness.
Yeah. Also, you got when you were editing it, the part where he yawned. You got to tell him that story.
Oh, okay. So, we were throwing around several ideas, and we decided to take one out. And I'm editing the script, and I accidentally took out a bit of narrative where, you know, where Quinn yawns and he scratches his stomach. I accidentally took that out for a minute. I'm like, whoa, I gotta put that back in. Because if that is not in there, Christina will kill me. Because she, for some reason, loves it when Quinn does stuff like that.
Yeah.
When Quinn is just his mundane self, she loves it.
I know. Because when you read it, I was like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm so glad you kept that in, bro. I was really happy.
Like, you know how, like, we're getting all these Quinn feels. It's like, oh, yeah, Quinn's in his VJs. Quinn's eating his pancakes. I'm like,
and Russell's a ghost.
Yeah, no. Well, where it mentions, it's like, Russell never really saw the sunrise much. He was never really up at this hour. Well, not without the help of, like, a gallon of coffee. And I typed to Christina after I typed that line, nobody cares about your coffee addiction, Russell. Yeah, it's funny because, like, Russell's not a morning person, but, like, he runs out of stuff to do, like, during the night because, like, he writes all those papers and he's like, okay, I got over all my memories. Like, okay, I made some pancakes. He's like, now what am I going to do? I'll go ride to sunrise. It's like, I've never seen one of those before.
The sun rises?
The sun rises?
What?
What is that? What is that? It's like that one time, it's like your house was like really dark and then we went outside and then it was like really
super
bright.
Super bright. We're like, my eyes.
We were like, oh, the hideous light of the morning day star.
I remember that.
Yeah, and I was like that freaking was out.
Dude, I haven't saw a sunrise in years.
I saw one this morning.
Yes.
What?
Why?
Yeah, I was up to take Sav to her orientation thing.
Oh.
Yeah, I took a friend to a work orientation this morning, which was okay. She was there from 8 a.m. until 4 p.m. So, like, for orientation. So they had her there that long.
Wow.
And it was
crazy.
Crazy. So, crazy. So, but yeah.
So, yeah.
So I saw the sunrise this morning.
Good
there
for you.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think we've gone over both your thoughts. Do you have anything else to add?
We're good.
If not, we'll give you a preview for the next.
Yep.
Preview.
Yay.
Okay, so they are going to go drive around town and look for triggers to see if anything triggers Russell's memories. Shut up.
It's a new word.
Triggers.
It's like trigger and jugular. Triggular.
Oh, God. That's what I was thinking.
So they're going to go around looking for triggers for Russell, and they find one.
Oh my.
Yeah.
Oh my.
Guess who it is? Write us on Facebook or Twitter.
Yes.
Does
it's a person.
Do you have an idea?
It's a person.
Oh, yeah. I have an idea, but I'm not gonna say it.
No, say it. We can't. Well, just say maybe, whoever it is. Whoever it is, we'll just say maybe.
I'm gonna mess up his name. The 14-year-old boy.
Maybe.
The boy who got the powers. That's my guess.
Maybe.
Maybe. Okay.
I think it's a bunny.
Maybe, but no.
Yes.
No. Yes.
Yes. Yes. You're saying yes to the bunny.
It's a white bunny.
Russell is like
holding a purple carrot.
This dramatic moment. They just stop the car. Stop the car. You just like focus it on this bunny, like.
And Quinn's like fluffy bunny. Let me pet the fluffy bunny.
Or and then you're like riding, I'll have to go catch it.
Or it could be like the commercial, the car commercial where a woman is screaming in the car and they're about to hit a deer and the deer screams. Into the wildlife are screaming.
But yeah.
Sorry.
No, it's funny. Your face is hilarious.
Oh, God.
Yeah, but a little more preview is, they're driving around town, and Russell sees this person, whose identity will be concealed until next week. He sees this person, and it's kind of cute in my mind, because he phases slightly out of the car to get a better look, and he's like, Quinn, stop the car! Pull over the car now! And he's like, what, really now?
Right now?
Right now? Because I pictured them kind of being in an
interstate. They're gonna get me killed!
Oh, no!
Then we'll be both ghosts.
And that's how it ends.
Oh, that just ends with
terrible ending.
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna sign off now, folks, because I'm starving.
Yeah.
Okay.
You need some pancakes.
I need pancakes. Yeah. Okay, signing off is our newest member, Clarice.
Yay!
sleep.
Yay!
Have a good night, you guys.
Oh, that was so cute.
Oh, she's always cute. Adorable.
And our lovely narrator who is back. I'm so glad you're back.
Yes, it was good to be back. Have a good night, guys.
And our co-host, Georgia.
Hi. I'm the co-host, signing off, Georgia McCartney.
And this is your host, Christina Zordich, on Snark Actors on the Airwaves. And you were listening to WRMU 91.1, Radio Voice of Mount Union. And we hope to see you again next week. We love you. Good night, and have a great weekend.